Good morning, everyone.
Thanks for everyone, to everyone for joining me this morning. It is a lovely, lovely Sunday morning. And we are, I think we're always fortunate to get together because the purpose of getting together is Torah and history and Yiddishkeit in its many facets. Today I've brought some different books and I'd like to be able to share ideas, not only about Torah, but also about today, the 15th, what is its significance? And we always, always start with the Tefillah Lishlom HaMedina. Welcome to everyone. Hopefully you're all enjoying good health. Im Yirtzeh Hashem, we'll just look ahead with much, much joy and optimism. Avinu Shebashamayim, Tzur Yisrael v'Goalo, ברך את מדינת ישראל, ראשית צמיחת גאולתנו. הגן עליה בעברת חסדך, ופרוס עליה סוכת שלומך, ושלח אורך ועמיתך לראשיה, שריה ויועציה, ותקנם ביצה טובה מלפניך. חזק את ידי מגיני ארץ קודשנו, והנחילם אלוהינו ישוע. ועטרת ניצחון תאטרם, ונתת שלום בארץ ושמחת עולם ליושביה, ונאמר אמן. Our special tefillah for the state of Israel, and we'll start with, today we'll start with counting of the Omer, because we're coming up to a monumental date in the, within the counting, we're coming up to Lag BaOmer on Thursday, but today is only the 29th. Just to remind you, when it says mitzvat aseh, it means it's a positive commandment. Remember, the commandments are divided into positive and negative. Some of them say do, and the others say do not do. The positive mitzvah is to count. So that's how the bracha starts. We start with Hineni mekayem mitzvat aseh shel sfirat haomer, kemo shekatuv batorah, as it is written in the Torah. וספרתם לכם ממחרת השבת מיום הביאכם את עומר התנופה שבע שבתות תמימות תהיינה עד ממחרת השבת השביעית תספרו 50 יום שבע שבתות means 7 full weeks and then on the 50th we celebrate a holiday. And so just to remind all of us, in the Torah it never says the date of Shavuot, but it does tell us how to get to that date by counting from the second night of Pesach until Shavuot, a total of 49 days. The 50th is Shavuot. We, in our tradition, associate Shavuot with not only as a harvest festival, but also as the most important concept of standing around Mount Sinai to receive the Torah, and that Rabbi Sacks says, is our opportunity to become a nation. And after we say all that, we say a bracha, because it's a positive mitzvah. Baruch atah Hashem, Elokeinu melech haolam, asher kitshanu b'mitzvotah v'tzivanu al sfirat haomer. Sfirat haomer means the counting of the omer. And then we say, hayom tisha ve'esrim yom, shehem arba'a shavuot v'yom echad laomer. How do we count? 29 days, 9 and 20 days, which are 4 weeks and 1 day in the Omer. And when we will reach Thursday, we will be saying Shloshim Ushloshayom, which is Lag. Lag literally equals a Lamed, which is 30, a Gimel, which is 3, total of 33. And we'll talk about Lag BaOmer briefly very soon. There is a closing prayer to this Sfirat HaOmer. Remember, it's recited daily. And in some very, really a very specific way, Lag BaOmer and counting of the Omer is so much about Jewish identity. It's so much about maintaining our Jewish identity and being the link. The link, what kind of a link? Well, if we're going to have a chain that's going, we need to be that link in the chain, not to let go. And Rabbi Greenberg says, for the covenantal way to continue we must keep the human chain going. And so the counting of the Omer is a way to strengthen our identity because we are the link in the chain. We belong. And that is very powerful. The story is about Rabbi Akiva that I wanted to read from the book by Chaim Halevi Donit. Rabbi Akiva there's a little story about him. You know, whenever we say L'chaim, what do we mean? L'chaim means to life, right? And we often raise a glass. And so the classical Jewish toast before drinking wine, what do we say? L'chaim. And this is not a blessing in the traditional sense, of course, but it's a prayer. And it is said, and it should precede the bracha that we say over the wine. The toast is definitely Jewish, but Judaism places great stress upon life. And it has Talmudic origin. It's credited to Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva lived in the second century. We'll speak a little bit more about him because of Lag BaOmer. And it was apparently the custom during that period to give wine to bereaved persons who were sitting Shiva. It must have been considered an important use for the wine to judge by the statement made by Rabbi Hanin that wine was created only for the purpose of comforting mourners. It's in the Talmud. It was then known as the cup of comfort. Sometimes you hear it, cup of consolation, right? On joyous occasions, therefore, the hope was expressed that the drinking of the wine should continue to be a l'chaim for life, for the reasons of joy and gladness, rather than bereavement. Now, when Rabbi Akiva once made a banquet in honor of his son Simon, he said, as he brought each glass of wine to the life and the health of the rabbis and their disciples. And I have all kinds of notes about where we could find it in the Talmud. Rabbi Akiva is the one who actually died a martyr's death. He was that incredible man who started late at the age of 40 and became a celebrated rabbi of the Mishnah. And when we talk about Rabbi Akiva and all the other Chachamim, and we did a little bit at Pesach time, right? Because they're in the Haggadah. Today we want to stress his role in the second revolt against the Romans, which is the year 135. And today we're talking about a terrible emperor, terrible because he was really cruel. His name is Hadrian, not Adrian. And apart from anything else, there were so many people who died during that revolt. Now, to be fair, does a tiny little country like Judea think that it's possible to fight against the mighty Roman Empire? Well, they were doing really, really well until the emperor decided to send a very seasoned commander of the troops. And by then, because the Roman emperor could not afford to lose against little Judea. It says in my book, the book of history, The History of the Jewish People by Solomon Greisel, that the slave markets were again glutted with Jewish captives. This is what they used to do. Instead of, obviously they could kill them, but instead they would sell them as slaves. And so the slave markets were filled with Jewish captives, and Judea lay desolate after this second revolt in the year 135. It took about 3 years. And if you recall, Rabbi Akiva was very, very supportive of it, especially the very strong man called Bar Kokhba, whose original name was Bar Kozeba. Bar Kokhba, that he changed his name to the son of a star. And he was really mighty. But finally, he too was caught. And so it is that what were the results of this terrible revolt? Let me read it to you. It's very, very reminiscent of what happened in the time of the Maccabees. So even before the fighting was over, Jerusalem was they were starting to rebuild it as a pagan city. They wanted to call it Elia Capitolina, right? And the Jews were furious. This new city was obviously going to be a Roman, a pagan city. And the Jews were prohibited from coming near the city. But thereafter, annually on the day, many would come from every part of the country and bribe the Roman soldiers to let them weep over the ruins of their former glory. And Hadrian, the emperor, prohibited the practice of Judaism. He forbade circumcision and the observance of Shabbat. He thought this was the way to eradicate Judaism. Obviously, the calendar was not being fixated because the calendar would indicate holidays. And the academy that was established by Yochanan ben Zakkai in Yavne was also closed. Now, in fact, Hadrian prohibited study and teaching, and anyone found studying the Torah was punished by death. And that's what happened to Rabbi Akiva, because Rabbi Akiva said there's no Judaism without Torah, and therefore he took that chance, knowing that he'll be caught. And so Lag BaOmer, why is that a time that's different? Lag BaOmer was the time when many of his soldiers, his students, Rabbi Akiva's students, who were hardy soldiers, who had died in the war as well as from a plague. Many of those students were not buried until Lag BaOmer, once again, to punish the Jewish people. This is what Hadrian thought was going to be successful. Bar Kokhba did meet with a lot of success against the Roman soldiers. And Jerusalem at first was taken by the Jews. And in fact, in order to show independence, coins were made during the time of the Bar Kokhba rebellion. Coins always indicate that we are now independent. And we know that with a regular Roman army, there was a tremendous energy put into the fight against the Judeans, and there was no chance. Beitar was surrounded, eventually conquered. So the fall of Beitar obviously was the end of Bar Kokhba. Many people are very critical of Rabbi Akiva that this is what he supported, because war is a time of terrible loss. I don't have to spell that out. It just is. But the Romans eventually came to the realization that persecuting Judaism will not work, right? The academies were reopened through Palestine, and perhaps the center moved over to Usha and eventually moved again. But we continued, even though not owners of our own, not independent, we as a people continued. Is that a chapter of glory, or is it actually perhaps despair? I'm wondering how you see it. Because war is clearly a time of terrible, terrible pain, terrible losses. Now, in our parasha, but let's just do one more thing about Lag BaOmer. In his book, this Know Your Festivals, Morris Golom is talking about Lag BaOmer. How is it celebrated? If you've been in Israel for Lag BaOmer, you know that people are making bonfires for a few weeks before. All the children are looking around to see little twigs and all kinds of pieces of wood in order to create a very large bonfire. Unfortunately, you may recall that last year at Meron was quite a terrible disaster, a horrific disaster. And I guess we can celebrate Lag BaOmer in the same way. Traditionally, everyone would go to Meron and there would be a hilulah. The tradition is that Shimon Bar Yochai, one of the scholars, is buried there. And again, according to tradition, Shimon Bar Yochai and his son spent 13 years in a cave because they were afraid to show up. The Romans wanted to catch them. Anyways, do we observe Lag BaOmer? It's not a religious holiday. There are no prayers, nothing specific, But it is called the Scholars' Holiday. Why? Because scholars are the students of Rabbi Akiva. Many of them did perish. Some of them remained alive. And so we call Lag BaOmer the Scholars' Holiday. According to our tradition, children and people took bows and arrows and went through the woods, in a sense, fooling the Roman soldiers. We as children in Israel bring bows and arrows and enjoy the outing of Lag BaOmer. It's a scholar's day, a name that was given to Lag BaOmer. Remember that Lag literally means 33. And so for many, many traditional Jews, Lag is the division between the first part of the Omer and the second part of the Omer. And for many people, weddings will be permitted after Lag BaOmer. And remember that it is a time of semi-mourning because of what happened in the time of Rabbi Akiva. There are many, many questions regarding Lag BaOmer. The one I want to touch on is, what is an Omer? Just to remind you, the counting of the Omer, but what is an Omer? An Omer is a measure of freshly cut grain that was brought into the temple during the weeks between Passover and Shavuot. So remember, everything does in those days center around agricultural festivals, agricultural blessings. So an Omer would be brought into the temple during the weeks between Passover and Shavuot. Just to get a kind of a visual, I see that counting of the Omer as the bridge that connects Pesach and Shavuot. Pesach, obviously, going out from Egypt, and 50 days later, everyone is standing around Mount Sinai, and that's what we might want to call the Exodus experience, or the Exodus morality. What is that? According to Rabbi Greenberg, in his Jewish way, and I've spoken about his book many times, he calls it the Exodus principle. And that is how it connects to what we're talking about in the parasha, the Exodus principle. What is the Exodus principle? The parasha is talking about the Shemitah. How is that connected to the Exodus? The Exodus morality, according to him, it means exactly what we already know: giving justice to the poor and to the weak, honesty, for example, in weights and measures. That is part of the Exodus mandate. Leaving part of the crops in the field for strangers and orphans and widows. It's all about what we said, the agricultural. But agricultural connects with our mandate as a people who care about the vulnerable. What else? Treating strangers with the same respect to justice as we treat native citizens. Rabbi Greenberg says that all this transformed the Israelites. And he calls it either the Exodus mentality or the Exodus principle to living. The Exodus principle to living obviously includes not causing the slave terrible pain, not insulting people, all of that that is encapsulated in the message that Jews got at Sinai. Sinai, remember, is really not a geographic location. It's an idea. It's an idea we take with us, and accepting the Torah, we accept it every day, every single day that we do. What's the take-home message for Rabbi Greenberg? The take-home message is, the lesson is that a slave needs help to get started on liberation. A slave needs help to get started on liberation because people in general are conditioned to accept servitude as the norm. And how does that apply today? Are you a slave? Are we slaves? Are we in fact enslaved? Some people may be enslaved to addiction. Some people may be enslaved to many other things. We won't even try to find out. It may just be that in our modern times, especially people who don't close up shop for Shabbat. By the way, Shabbat, he says, is a gift that keeps on giving. those people who don't stop and change their pace for Shabbat, they may have a servitude, a specific servitude, like electronic devices. That too is the take-home message. A slave may need help to get started on the road to liberation. Did we? Yes, Israelites did, and we got that help. That's how Shemitah in the parasha is connected to the Exodus idea. Not only that, but if Shemitah means a sabbatical year, every seventh year the land will lie fallow, why would they get all this? The sages ask. Why would they get this information at Sinai? They don't even have land. They're not even close yet to the land. Someone sent me this wonderful, wonderful, I guess it's a comic strip. Moses is looking at his devices saying, we are going to arrive in 40 years. He says, that can't be right. But of course, 40 years later, we do. Rabbi Greenberg then is connecting the Shemitah, which is an economic reset, by making sure that on the seventh year, the land lies fallow and no one can work it, and everyone is allowed to go into that field and either glean from the field or take fruit from the trees. It belongs to everyone. It's, of course, an economic way of saying the poor are also entitled. Everyone can take what they need, not more than they need. That, too, is the lesson of Shemitah, and we're going to look at the text itself, and therefore, what do we glean from that? Again, just to complete the thought with Rabbi Greenberg, he's suggesting that, and I'd like you to consider that. You know, we talk a lot about holidays. Now, for many, the past is irrelevant, but for Jews, it's not. We relive these holidays, right? And so the past is not irrelevant. It is most relevant. It is what we enact. And therefore, you can say that the Exodus paradigm is, think about it, the Exodus paradigm is making the impossible become possible. Because it looked impossible, and yet here it is, it becomes possible. And for the rabbis, each and every day has to be a day of remembering Egypt, the outgoing from Egypt, that. And in Rabbi Greenberg's words, through the holiday cycle of the year and other rituals, the past can be summoned up to infuse the present with meaning. All of it gives us meaning. It is part of our mandate to remember. We are required to remember. So it is, therefore, we are in a sense reliving the Exodus, because the past is relevant for us, for Jewish people. The past continues to be relevant. Now, he's saying that in biblical times, and this is important because you thought, or you may have thought, that in biblical times there was counting of the Omer that was sad, but no. He reminds us that the entire period between Passover and Shavuot was a happy time. In the rabbinic era, however, the 7 weeks became a period of sadness and mourning, right? That is only since the year 135 of the Common Era. The Talmud speaks of the plague that decimated the students of Rabbi Akiva. It's entirely possible that the plague was, in fact, a Roman purge of Rabbi Akiva's students for the crime of being involved in that rebellion led by Bar Kokhba against Rome. Rabbi Akiva, obviously, some people have criticized and questioned whether that was good advice to fight. And yet, Rabbi Akiva felt it was worth the price. So how are we reliving the Exodus? By making sure that there's justice for the poor. That is our way of reliving the Exodus. In the parasha itself, it says clearly in parashat Behar, most of the years Behar is coupled, is read together with the Chukotai. This year is leap year. We're reading Behar by itself. Parashat Behar literally means at the mountain or in the mountain, on the mountain. Let's read it. Vayedaber Hashem el Moshe Behar Sinai lemor. Daber al bnei Yisrael v'amart alehem. And therefore the important word in this first line is Behar. And that's how the parasha gets its name. When you enter the land that I assign to you, the land shall observe a Sabbath of the Lord. That means that you have to observe the Sabbath of the Lord. In other words, 6 years you may sow your field, 6 years you may prune your vineyard and gather the yield, but in the seventh year, the land shall have a Sabbath of complete rest. The land is going to have rest. Their big argument is it may be just a very clever way of giving the land a chance to replenish. The commentary is saying that it may just help this amount of sodium be deleted from the earth. And the commentary is saying something important. This is a plan. The plan is that families could reclaim the land that they held originally and later sold. When do families sell their land? If they're desperate, if they cannot sustain their families, and they've had some bad luck or bad management, and it may be years of famine, they may be forced to sell the land. The concept here is, in Parashat Behar, and we're going to read the most famous of all words. What are the most famous words that maybe a lot of people know? And it says, in Parashat Behar, proclaim release throughout the land for all its inhabitants. The word dror is actually freedom, if you like. Commentary says the clause is inscribed where? On the Liberty Bell. We're going to look at that in a minute. Some commentators derive the word dror, release, from the Hebrew word root dar, to dwell, and understand it to mean the freedom to live wherever one wants. In fact, Rashi feels that way too. The freedom to live wherever you want. But they chose to take this pasuk from the book of Leviticus in this parasha and inscribe it on the Liberty Bell. And so it is very, very important for us to remember that the concept of liberty is so important for us as a people. Let's read then what it's talking about the 50th year, because 7 times 7 is 49, and then comes the 50th. The 50th year, families would reclaim the land that they had originally, they had held originally, then they had to sell it. And behind this plan are two assumptions, because all the earth and all its inhabitants belong to God. Human beings cannot possess either the land or the people. And no human being should be condemned to permanent servitude. So some critics have seen this as a utopian plan that never was put into practice. What wasn't put into practice? So when the 50th year would come, the mandate is that the original owners, the original family owners, the original family would get its piece of land back. In other words, to create a little bit more equality for the economic well-being of the people. Archaeologists have found records of deeds from the late biblical period containing references to the number of years remaining till the Jubilee year. So they would keep on counting, right? Until you get to the 50th, it may be that people didn't live as long in those days, which is more than likely. So why does the Torah emphasize that these agricultural laws were at Mount Sinai? What's the question that the sages ask? Why are you telling all this at Mount Sinai? The people haven't got any land to speak of. They're not owners of anything. And the agricultural tradition hasn't started there in the wilderness. Is that a legitimate question? Shemitah? The land will lie fallow after 7 years, after 6 years. Well, how does it apply? And by the way, it's repeated in the book of Deuteronomy. We'll look at it too. Here is what the commentary says. At Sinai, no one owned any land and no one could object that the law deprived people of what they had worked to acquire, which is one way of looking at it. It is easier to propose a visionary system of equality when all start out equal, because no one had land, therefore all are equal. Another interpretation, and remember last week we spoke the importance of interpretation. Just as Sinai was the smallest of the mountains, but the word spoken there changed the world. So the people, Israel, among the smallest of the nations, present a vision of social justice that has the power to change the world. Shemitah is a, and by the way, it's not only the land, we'll refer to money as well. What is the issue here? It was supposed to create more equality because in addition to the fact that people may have sold themselves into slavery in order to sustain themselves or their family, they are protected by the law not to overwork them or treat them with disdain. They have unfortunately been forced to leave their own freedom and become the slave, but they are to be treated as indentured workers, not to be abused as a slave. In fact, there's always the law that slaves need to have our consideration. And we said also that the Liberty Bell, and that is on page, it is chapter 25. And I think that it's incredible. Let's just refer to someone called Zalek Pliskin that I really enjoy. And in addition to that, Hillel. Who's Hillel? Hillel lives about 2,000 years ago. And in his time, he understood that there was an economic need. Let's explain it. If on the seventh year, slaves go back and all debts would be called off, that created a problem because people might not want to lend money. And when people are in need, all of this became an economic problem for the community. Therefore, there is something called prosbul. It's a word to denote that even if you lend money, the seventh year will come, that money that you lend is now in the hands of the court. It is not annulled, it's not forgotten. The court will take care of it. So that the machinery, if you like, of an economic well-being continues. Here is what Rabbi Birnbaum says. When economic life became more complex and debts incurred in transactions belonged to another category, Hillel, the famous Hillel, you know, the one who makes a sandwich on Pesach. The famous Hillel instituted a method for the adjustment of the law. It's, if you like, it's not really a fiction. It is circumventing the law in order to secure creditors against the operation of Shemitah so that they should not be reluctant to lend. Shemitah, by the way, you know, the word Shabbat means to stop, right? That's what Shabbat really means, to cease. So the method was known as prosbul, a legal instrument drawn up by the creditor. Why? Because the judges were empowered, the courts were empowered to collect the debt due to the person who lent money at the time that he was supposed to get it. So Hillel lived in 2,000 years ago. You meet him in the Mishnah. And what did he say that we love? Im eina nili mili. I can't be only for myself. but I need to be for myself as well, right? And if not now, when? Today, I'm going to look at the Mishnah just for a couple of minutes. Hopefully, time will permit, because this is traditionally a time to look at the Mishnah, specifically the ethics of the fathers. So we'll do that. So the sabbatical year, the debts that had already been secured by order of the court before Shemitah were not lost. And so we needed to have that as a reality for understanding the economic well-being of a community. I also want to be able to tell you that all of these mitzvot are simply enumerated in Sefer HaChinuch. And if I wanted to, I could look at each one specifically. Today, it says in Parashat Behar, there are 24 mitzvot. And the first one is not to work the land on the seventh year. It gives me all kinds of details. And we cannot work the trees either. We're not allowed to be looking after the trees. It's a time of rest. So these are mitzvot. What number is it? Well, it's 326. And the next one. So remember, out of 613, we're already in 326. The mitzvah that I want to talk about today is about insulting and defrauding people. We want to look at that together. And what it says clearly is that peace is of paramount importance. And therefore, we have to be aware that when we insult people or we defraud people, it's not only a sin, but we're undermining the society. And Parashat Behar is very much aware of that we should not cause people pain, we should not embarrass them, and that we should be aware that in dealing with people, we should not cause a situation in which we have taken advantage of them. It's called ona'a or ona'at dvarim, and that may be words or it may be money. It does say that words when we are cheating someone are even more serious, because you cannot take the words back. With money, you could perhaps make up for it, but you cannot take the words back. So this is in my Sefer HaChinuch. And so there are two such mitzvot. Rabbi Artson is an American, the Liberty Bell. What's important about that? Well, the Puritans, right, they're Americans, and they came to America. They viewed themselves as the modern embodiment of ancient Israel. Like the Israelites, they saw themselves as fleeing from an oppressive Pharaoh. And remember, they were running away too, journeying into the wilderness in pursuit of freedom and the establishment of a religious and a democratic society. Right, so it's no coincidence that on the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia, the Hebrew Bible proclaims the ancient ideal, proclaim liberty throughout the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. So like the ancient Jews, these colonial Americans saw their mission as one of proclaiming liberty. And so Rabbi Artson is asking, what is liberty? What is liberty, let's say, to Rashi? Well, of freedom. Rashi says, remember that Rashi lives in the 11th century, and he says that freedom is freedom from subjugation to the authority of others. You may recall that towards the end of his life, he also experienced crusades. So people speak about things that they feel and that they see. It says Rashi understands freedom to imply the ability to reside anywhere you want to, anywhere that you choose to. So that's about liberty. And it's a very big topic. It's hardly, it's a big topic about what is freedom, what is liberty. It's probably a whole big topic all by itself. So now let's go back to the idea of what is it that we are commanded by the Torah not to do. We are not allowed to insult people and defraud people. I'm in chapter 25 and it's verse 17. Do not wrong one another, but fear your God, for I, the Lord, am your God. Don't wrong other people. How do we wrong them? What could we be doing? We may be cheating in business. We may be taking advantage. One of the wonderful things that Zalek Pliskin does in his book, Love Your Neighbor, he brings it down to the practical, to the doable, or that which is scary. Defrauding in a transaction, we understand that. Or wounding a person's feelings by saying the bad words. And therefore there's the story of the tongue. The tongue. You know very well, in Hebrew we say, ha-chayim ve-hamavet b'yad ha-lashon, that the way we speak could either cause life or death. The Midrash relates, says Rabbi Pliskin, that at a feast that Rabbi Yudanasi hosted, he served tongue. And he noticed how each person selected a tender slice, leaving over the tougher pieces. He used the opportunity to point out to his disciples that one must always choose a soft word, leaving over those that are harsh. Choose soft words. Don't use bad or harsh words. And so that's so true. And furthermore, Rabbi Pliskin talks about that. We're obligated to help somebody because sometimes we said a person in your community may be having a very bad time and is on the brink of poverty. What can we be doing to assist that person? Because when your brother grows poor, says my parasha, and his means fail him, when he is with you, then you shall uphold him. You shall help hold him up. That's the meaning of uphold here. Let's look and see what Rabbi Pliskin suggests. How can we maintain a society in which there's more justice and more equity? Some of the ideas in this wonderful text is you're forbidden to falsely advertise. That's completely modern. You cannot falsely advertise or in any way falsely praise an item that you wish to sell. In other words, you need to be honest, not only in weights and measures, but the item. And then he says also, you're forbidden to mix inferior quality fruit, let's say, with superior quality in order to sell the fruit at superior quality prices, which of course means that at the top there might be very nice fruit and at the bottom where you don't see may not be the nicest. Rabbi Pliskin continues in saying that you're wronging another person by misleading them. So it's permissible for a storekeeper, listen to this one, if you wanted to give some sweets to children so that they and their parents will patronize the store. In other words, oh, I want to go to that store because he gives me candies, right? Rabbi Pliskin says, that's okay. You're allowed to do that. It's also permissible for a storekeeper to sell goods cheaper than the market price if he wants to, because he's trying to get more customers. But then when it comes to velo tonu ish et amito, we're forbidden to hurt the feelings of others. Once again, Rabbi Pliskin reminds us, whatever you would want someone to say to you, you know the rest. It's doing for someone else what you'd want done to yourself, or not doing what you would obviously not want done to you. Insulting someone is worse than cheating him financially. How could that be? Insulting someone is worse than cheating him financially? Yes, money can be returned, but pain caused by words cannot be erased. Cheating someone affects his purse, but vexing and angering someone with words affects the person himself. And therefore you are forbidden. And people do that all the time. What do we do sometimes? And we should keep that in mind. We go into a store and we ask a price. Oh, that looks like a very lovely, I don't know, purse. Very nice shoes. I'll ask the price. Do we have intentions of buying? If we have no intentions of buying, we are misleading the storekeeper. I know it might be just people working for him, but very often it's called misleading. Here are the words. You're forbidden to ask a storekeeper how much money he wants for a certain item if you have no intention of buying it. For then you are arousing false hopes by the storekeeper. Oh, the store is full of people, but how many of them are buying? In other words, if you enter a store and you're curious about the price of an article but have no intentions of buying it, you should explicitly tell the shopkeeper that you're just looking out of curiosity. These are the words of Rabbi Pliskin. We should not mislead the shopkeeper who says, oh, wow. And in terms of words, you're forbidden to remind a person of his past misdeeds or the misdeeds of his family, for this will cause him discomfort. And this is specifically for people who are converts. We should not remind them that they were just whatever. We need to be very, very much aware of a person's dignity. The story that I love is about Shimon ben Gamliel says to a servant, go to the marketplace. You may know that story. He said, buy some food that is good. So Tavi, the servant, went to the marketplace and returned with tongue. Afterwards, Rabbi Shimon said to Tavi, go to the marketplace and buy some food that is bad. And Tavi again came back with more tongue. What is this? Said Rabbi Shimon. When I told you to buy food that's good, you brought tongue. And when I told you to buy food that's bad, you also brought tongue. So Tavi replied, from a tongue can come good, and from a tongue can come bad. And when a tongue is good, there's nothing better. But when a tongue is bad, remember, a tongue also means language. A tongue means words. When a tongue is bad, there is nothing worse. And that's from Vayikra Rabba. The story is in Rabbi Pliskin's book. And I'm going to just share two more things because of time. I still have a couple more things that I want to do. Many people scare children in jest, right? They might say the boogeyman's coming or something, right? Although they wouldn't do that to adults, a person must be sensitive to the feelings of a child as he would be sensitive to the feelings of an adult. And of course, we know about bullying. We know that, is that a modern idea, bullying? Is it? There are many, many people who tell me that when they were young, they experienced a lot of anti-Semitism too. They had to deal with that. Anyways, parents and teachers should train children not to insult their friends and their classmates and their relatives. To me, it's all about derech eretz. We need to have a sense of respect, whether we're children or we're adults. That is, as the Chachamim say, im ein Torah, ein derech eretz, im ein derech eretz, ein Torah. If you don't have derech eretz, then there's no Torah. You must have respect. And the last thing for the moment, always speak to people in a low tone of voice. Why? Well, this piece of advice was written by Ramban to his son. And he adds that this will stop you from growing angry at someone. And when feelings of anger well up inside of you, whisper. Your anger will soon subside. Lower your voice. Speak quietly. Don't let anger overtake you. much, much, much more wonderful advice by Rabbi Pliskin, in case you love it, and I do. The name of his book is Love Your Neighbor, Loving Your Neighbor. All of that is incredible. I'm going to jump to a couple of more things and then come back to the parasha. It's the 15th. I want to talk about a couple of things. First of all, it's Pesach Sheni. And Pesach Sheni in the Torah, if you're looking at it in the book of Deuteronomy, it says Pesach Sheni. What does it mean? And to me, Sheni means the second. You're not cleaning the dishes. You're not worried about all that. These are the people who had wanted to bring a sacrifice, but they were either impure, in other words, not permitted to come and bring a sacrifice, or they were far away and didn't get there in time. Pesach Sheni is about getting a second chance. Isn't it wonderful? You get a second chance to make Pesach. Okay. And so the Torah says in the book of Deuteronomy, and today is Pesach Sheni. What does that mean? Those people who want to, and I certainly do, it's a day for eating matzah. That's how we celebrate Pesach Sheni. The text itself in the book of, in the book of Numbers, chapter 9 says, and there were some men who were impure by reasons of a corpse, right? They were near a dead person and could not offer the Passover sacrifice. Appearing that same day, they came to Moses and they said, whoa, impure though we are by reason of a dead body, why must we be debarred from presenting to the Lord the offering, the Pesach offering? And so the answer is yes. If you were far away or you were not eligible, if you like, you weren't acceptable, then a month later, and it says that in verse number 9, speak to the Israelite people saying, when any of you or of your posterity who are defiled by a corpse or they're on a long journey, they can bring Pesach to God b'chodesh hasheni. Which is the chodesh hasheni, the second month? Well, remember in the Torah, the first month is Nisan, the month of the outgoing from Egypt. Second month is this month, the month of Iyar. This is the month on the 14th day we can do the Hillel sandwich. That's what it says at the bottom. This is what Al Matzot Umerorim Yochluhu. We can do a Hillel sandwich. We don't have to have maror, but you could. And eat some matzah today to remember that today is Pesach Sheni. And people wanted to have the opportunity to celebrate the second, it's a second chance. Most of the time we don't get a second chance, right? It doesn't usually happen. I'm going to jump, as I often do, and come back to Nechama Leibovich and of course Rabbi Sacks. Do you remember? You probably do. It was 1939 and it was May the 15th. What happened? 1939, May the 15th. Here is what our text, None is Too Many, by Irving Abella and Harold Schroeper. What do they tell us? They're telling us that it was May the 15th, 907 desperate German Jews set sail from Hamburg on this St. Louis. They'd been stripped of all their possessions. They were first hounded out of their homes and businesses. And like many who had sailed on this ship, these passengers had once contributed very much to their native land, to Germany. And they were distinguished, some of them well-educated and cultured, and they had been well off. Their most prized possession was their entrance visa to Cuba. Each one carried that. And when they reached Havana, which was 2 weeks later, their luck ran out. The Cuban government refused to recognize their entrance visas. And none of these men and women and children were allowed to disembark even after they threatened mass suicide. And the search for a haven now began in earnest. They tried to find another port, Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, Panama, in vain. In vain. Within 2 days, all the countries of Latin America had rejected entreaties to land. And then the St. Louis was forced to leave Havana Harbor. The last hope was Canada. Well, who was the prime minister? Well, his name was Mackenzie King. A wealthy, wealthy businessman sent a telegram to Mackenzie King and said that he should show the true Christian charity and offer the homeless exile sanctuary in Canada, but Jewish refugees were far from his concern. Mackenzie King was in Washington. He was with the royal family. There was a North American tour, and the St. Louis, King felt, was not a Canadian problem. I'll jump to tell you about the famous man called Blair. Infamous, actually. Blair claimed that these refugees did not qualify under immigration law, that in any case, Canada had already done much too much for the Jews. I'm quoting, right? Blair says, oh no, we can't open our doors to take in hundreds of thousands of Jewish people who want to leave Europe. The line must be drawn somewhere. The Globe and Mail and the Toronto Star, the Winnipeg Free Press continued their editorial assault. They called it cowardly, this government policy. It says Canada is missing the boat on the refugee question. And this is 6 weeks before the onset of the war. The captain of the ship, by the way, was a German. Telushkin tells us about it in his Jewish Literacy. And here is another little note that you may want to remember. Canada apologizes for the St. Louis in 1939. It will apologize for 2018. This has to do with something else. And it says, Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau formally apologized Wednesday on behalf of the nation for turning away a ship full of Jewish refugees trying to flee Nazi Germany in 1939. The German liner, the St. Louis, was carrying 907 German Jews. Was rejected by Cuba, the United States. Passengers were forced to return to Europe, and many of them died in the Holocaust. Trudeau called the apology long overdue. But Hitler watched as we refused their visas, ignored their letters, denied them entry, Trudeau said in Parliament. There is little doubt that our silence permitted the Nazis to come up with their own final solution in the so-called Jewish problem. So we want to remember those Jewish people and really commend the German captain of the ship. We may look at it, but it's extremely painful. Canada being a very, very large country. I know it's changed its policy since, but imagine how painful it is to say again and again, none is too many. Telushkin. Well, we've got a couple of minutes to look at Telushkin, not many minutes. And he is talking about the Gustav is his name, the German captain, Gustav Schroeder. He realized leaving Cuban and American territorial waters had nowhere to go, and he had to go back to Europe. Yeah. It was a sad, sad moment, certainly for Canadian history. And as Telushkin says, Hitler was ecstatic. For all that, world leaders publicly attacked Nazi anti-Semitism. They clearly didn't want the Jews any more than he did. All very difficult. And of course, there is that book, While 6 Million Died, First Systematic Account of FDR and Other Allied Leaders, Basic Indifference to the Fate of the Jews. There's a little story there about not trusting people, but we'll leave it for the moment and come back and say a couple of words regarding our parasha and open it up to your comments. Nechama talks about it, of course, Rabbi Sacks talks about it. What do we have in this amazing parasha? A parasha that talks about, and there's something quite magical. And of course, we know today that, you know, a professor gets a sabbatical in Israel. I know many teachers get a sabbatical. All of that is amazing. The concept, once again, Nechama wants to remind us, the concept of Mount Sinai is a concept that maybe some of these mitzvot weren't given there, but it's a concept. Many of these mitzvot may have been given later on. Maimonides, as always, Maimonides in his Guide for the Perplexed says that the laws concerning the year of Shemitah, some of them imply sympathy with our fellow men and promote the well-being of mankind. For in reference to these precepts, it is stated that the poor of your people may eat. How do we see this? Do we think only of the land that belongs to God? Or do we see it how it impacts on the society? How do we create a society in which the poor, the state of the poor people is alleviated by economic well-being that takes into account their poverty? Remember that in another one of our Chumashim, it says, there will not cease to be poor people in the society. Lo yechdal, it won't happen that poverty will be eradicated, that there won't be any poor people. And therefore, our mandate is to somehow lift them up, support them. And that's why, of course, Maimonides gives us various stages of tzedakah, each one of them important. How do we assist people? Maimonides continues in his guide, the land will also increase its produce and improve when it remains fallow for some time. Interestingly enough, Josephus, who was writing a little less than 2000 years ago, said that Julius Caesar exempted the Jews from certain taxes on the sabbatical year. Really quite amazing. So Nechama's point is that the guide, and you know, it almost is amazing how many items the guide deals with, that it really talks about life, real life. Nechama continues, the analogy between Shemitah and Shabbat is emphasized also by another author. Like Shabbat, it testifies that the world was created by God, for the land is mine, says Hashem. And he found a further allusion to this principle. 6 years correspond to the 6 days of creation. That's so true. And Torah the Kohanim is talking on the seventh day. That is for the Kohanim. And Shemitah is a year that referred to the Sabbath of the Lord. We can make these correlations. It may be noted that also Kito, that we said twice on the third and the sixth day, it's therefore that the tithe for the poor must be given every third and sixth year in order to be good to other people, to one's fellow man. This is a very appropriate hint. In other words, this reset, this whole idea of rethinking the economic reality is a way that at that time, especially for agricultural communities, it was an opportunity to take into account the poor, whether they're coming into the field, whether we are not working the land, so that everyone can come in and partake, all of us. So there's a lot more to say, and I'd like to just complete it with a couple of words from a book by Rabbi Boca. Let me just share that with you. And then we'll look at Rabbi Sacks. Rabbi Boca wrote a wonderful book called Zichrono Livracha, and it's called As a Tree by the Waters. It's his text about the ethics of the fathers. The ethics of the fathers is in the Mishnah. It's traditionally studied right now between Pesach and Shavuot. I chose a couple of things that I thought were relevant, but it's full of wisdom. It is incredible. Pick up the ethics of the fathers to get more and more ideas. We as a people, that means our wonderful learning community together with Alan, we really listen to Shammai. We listen to Hillel for sure, but Shammai says, he's not really an opponent, but he has a different take. Shammai lived during the time of Hillel. They disagreed, but with much respect. And I think the whole parasha of Behar is about respecting the feelings of other people, respecting the fact that we need to be gentle with our words, just consider it. Shammai says, "Ase toratcha keva, emor me'at ve'ase harbe, ve'heve mekabel et kol ha'adam b'sevar panim yafot." Wonderful lessons. Let's explain them. Shammai says, make your Torah study a fixed duty. It doesn't say duty, but keva. Keva means regular. Regular. Every Sunday morning at 10:30, we get together. That's called Ase Toratcha Keva. It's exactly what Shammai says, because if you don't leave time for studying, it's not going to happen, right? Otherwise, we never find enough time. And so Ase Toratcha Keva. Make it a regular. Regular. And then he says, Emor me'at ve'ase harbe. Don't do too much. It's almost like saying, don't promise too much. Don't speak more than you must, because you should speak less and do more. In other words, don't promise to do something and then do much less. Turn that around. You might promise a little bit, but do much more. Ve'ase harbe, and do more. And the last part of that is, be sure to welcome each and every person with a cheerful countenance. Welcome people with that feeling, I'm so glad that you're here. I know these are COVID times, but the idea being that you are lending that feeling of joy when someone has come. So, the purpose of study, says Rabbi Boca, the purpose of study is to translate acquired wisdom into practice. It's not good enough to say things, but what will you do? It's wise to say little and do much, so that little energy is wasted on talking about what has been or will be achieved. All energies and time dedicated to real achievements. This saves time for more achievements or even for more periods of study. He goes on and says, greet all people with a pleasant face. You're helping people with the way you speak to them. That's what he says. People who are sensitive and need warmth, as much as they may need help, do not cut off your nose to spite their face. Don't be insensitive. Don't be insensitive. Always be aware, Rabbi Boca, always be aware and attentive to the people you relate with and ensure that sharing itself is done with a certain amount of graciousness. And the last one is equally powerful. Whoa, I know it speaks to me anyways. Rabbi Talfon is another one of the Tanaim. They're all, so instead of a story, I really think that this in chapter 2 says something so powerful. Rabbi Tarfon says, "Hayom katzar v'amlacha merubah v'apoalim atzelim v'asachar harbeh v'al habayit dochek." What is he concerned with? The day is short and the task is great. So true. What day is short? Well, the commentary says by Rabbi Volka, each individual is only allotted a finite stay in the world, and the task is great. The task itself is an infinite, never-ending one. Every moment wasted is a wasted opportunity. So the day is short, the task is great. The workers are lazy, says Rabbi Tarfon. Not everyone's really willing to put in a full day's work. And the reward is great. And the master of the house is insistent. Who's the master of the house? You might think that it's any boss. The boss may be insistent. But really, I see in my text that master is with a capital, referring therefore to Hashem. The day is short. It is. The task is great. Yes, it is. And then it says, the people may be lazy. They may be wasting their time, or what they call in English, killing time. But there's so much to be gained. Hasachar harbeh. Why is everything so short in the Mishnah? Why is it so short? Just to remind you, the Mishnah is written about 1800 years ago, a little bit more. Everything is handwritten. Everyone had to memorize because a lot of people didn't have a text. What did they do? They memorized it. And therefore, the aphorisms, the sayings are all short. And it's so much easier to memorize that way. So, Hayom katzer v'amlacha merubah, four words. In English, of course, we'll use 20 instead. And so here it what it says. Those who toil in the world are committed to doing the work of, hopefully, righteousness. They're dedicated. But there's a big task to be done, lots and lots to do. Relative to the great task, which must be approached in a short life. Were they truly aware of what must be achieved, they would not relax from their responsibility. And one more thing by Rabbi Volka, the reward is great. Remember the reward of achievement, the reward of a mitzvah, the work is the arena of life and is the most rewarding work. For even if it might bring many frustrations, and it does, nevertheless, ultimately, sincere commitment and dedication to the task enhances the quality of life itself, makes life worth living, and even brings ultimate rewards. Pirkei Avot by Rabbi Volka. Rabbi Sacks talks about that as well, because he says work brings dignity. Work brings us dignity. And it does. So since the time is short, we're just going to say a couple of words and share with you what he says. He says that the second example has to do with the treatment of Israelites forced to sell themselves. And why does Rabbi Sacks talk about that? Because there's so many topics that he does talk about. The issue, of course, is that we are not meant to be slaves. And I think that that is the lesson to be taken, you know, the take-home lesson. We're not meant to be enslaved. We may enslave ourselves, and that's another very big topic. We may be slaves to something, but we're not meant to be enslaved to other people. So, if that happens and we need to be working for someone, whether as an indentured hired worker or just working for someone, we're at the Torah saying to be treated with a great deal of dignity. So that's what Parashat Behar has. It creates a mechanism to correct the tendency towards a radical and ever-increasing inadequacy that result from this kind of the market economy. In those days, the market economy meant that people needed to work for other people if life became so difficult. So let's complete it with the words of Rabbi Sacks. Work, making a living, earning your daily bread has dignity. A psalm states, when you eat of the labor of your hand, you're happy, and that it shall be well with you. We say this every Saturday night at the start of the working week. Unlike other cultures, Judaism never dismisses work. It's part of the productive economy. It didn't favor the creation of a leisured class. Torah study without an occupation will in the end fail and lead to sin. Rabbi Sacks is quoting the Mishnah. Torah study without an occupation. Very interesting comment. You may want to comment on that. In the end, it will fail and lead to sin. He is a great believer that work must be part of a person's life. And finally, about tzedakah, and he's talking about the market economy, the free economy, right? It's the best system we know of alleviating poverty through economic growth. And we, by the way, that's exactly my topic tomorrow, the startup nation. What is it about the startup nation that made that an incredible economy? For those who have time to join me, I'll be hopefully starting at 1:30. And the topic is the startup nation. Definitely interesting. So it's time to say, מי שברך אבותינו אברהם יצחק ויעקב הוא יברך את חיילי צבא הגנה לישראל ואנשי כוחות הביטחון העומדים על משמר ארצנו וערי אלוהינו מגבול הלבנון ועד מדבר מצרים ומן הים הגדול עד לבוא הערבה ביבשה באוויר ובים ייתן אדוני את אויבינו הקמים עלינו ניגפים לפניהם הקדוש ברוך הוא ישמור ויציל את חיילינו מכל צרה וצוקה מכל נגע ומחלה, וישלח ברכה והצלחה, בכל מעשה ידיהם, ידבר שונאינו תחתיהם, ויתרם בחתר ישוע, ובעטרת ניצחון. ויקוים בהם הכתוב, כי אדוני אלוהיכם ההולך עמכם להילחם לכם, עם אויביכם להושיע אתכם, ונאמר אמן.
וישלח ברכה והצלחה בכל מעשה ידיהם הוא יברך את חיילך צבא הגנה לישראל.
We're talking about the amazing IDF soldiers. And what we mentioned today is that Rabbi Akiva didn't have amazing soldiers. He had many students and yet seemed to feel that it was worth the fight, because without Torah, we cannot continue.